This road will never end.
So those two scenes bookend the film. He starts at the road and he ends back at the same road. Only the approach to shooting those two scenes is completely different.
Unlike his other films up to that point, this is a film where he moved the camera more. There was more dolling, there was more shifting of points of view. We went onto the top of the highest building in Portland to shoot this, just a shot of, I guess it was the two of them on the motorcycle riding through Old Town. And it was a wonderful eagle's eye view of the streets. And then he also wanted a shot from the brake pedal of the motorcycle, looking up at the handlebars. Being able to sort of maintain an unbroken mood and maintain a visual continuity, you know, that really kind of tested me. But it was also just a moment of pure experimentation. It was the first time I really started skipping light off of the floors up into actors' faces. It was the first time I'd used contrast so heavily, black as much, you know. It's sort of like, you know, what do you withhold from the frame and what you show. It's more powerful poetically to withhold information. And when we were sort of in these moments where drama seemed a little more epic, you'd put a little more contrast or edge, or, you know. It was the first time I was able to feel really in command of, you know, all the tricks that I'd sort of known up to that point.
There were times when we did shots that were very, very considered, like the crane move into the porn shop. That's a very, very considered move and pulls you into this world, this really dark world that when you enter it, you enter slow motion and it's surreal. There's blinking lights, there's scary guys. You're in slow motion. You're kind of entering a bit of hell. But at the same time, once again, Gus offers comic relief by having the gay porn magazines come to life.
I still have to say that's probably been one of the most entertaining design jobs of my career, was making those magazine covers. This was in the sort of Stone Age when CGI was not available in any way to low-rent movies. And I'm pretty sure that it was Gus's idea that there had to be a sort of low-dollar solution to it. And I'm fairly certain that it was his idea what the solution would look like, which ended up being big sheets of plexiglass on which we stuck vinyl lettering and vinyl appliques to imply the fronts of the magazines. Background behind it, sandwiched the actor in between the plexiglass and the background, and there you have a living magazine cover.
We mocked up each individual magazine at a time, and around the front of it was sort of a kind of vinyl, I think it was like a vinyl wood grain pattern that resembled the wide shot of those actual shelves that were in the pornography store. And I just bounced light off of the inside. And the actors were really just really close to the glass like this.
It's when you start doing things for free that you start to grow wings. Isn't that right, Mike?
What?
Wings, Michael. You grow wings and become a fairy.
What do you care about money? Shit, you got plenty of money. Why don't you just go ahead and do whatever it is that you do? You can only imagine what that is for free.
Is that right, sweetie?
I don't think anybody would do anything this low rent anymore, even on very, very cheap movies. But I don't know. I think it still holds up.
Eric had been experimenting with this time lapse and coming up with really, really beautiful things. Eric always had a camera set up. He always had a camera doing time lapse of clouds and mountains.
To me, as I look at the film, the time lapse is really this atmospheric thing. And it's you know, it's done so early in the movie that Gus sets the tone and he sets the convention for breaking form very nicely. It was an atmospheric thing that seemed to sort of go well, you know, in creating this sort of mystique about Portland, about the Northwest. You know, and in the end it was gravy, you know, these were gravy shots.
there was a documentary aspect to this film, which required me with a camera on my shoulder to be able to follow River or to follow Keanu when they were moving around and improvising. There were times when I did shots where the light was so low and the focus was so critical that I literally had to touch River. I had to hold on to him and hold the camera on my shoulder in order to keep the shot in focus. I mean, I don't know how often you get to grab onto the actor and to do a kind of dance. River was a wildly ferocious and passionate, gentle and lovely soul, and to work in really close with him was a real honor. There were times when it seemed right to work with just available light, me, the camera, and Gus, and the actor. A good example of this is Grace Zabriskie is in the bedroom with Mike. It was just Gus and River and Grace and I, and we just used the practical lights for that scene. And I just grabbed the focus myself. There was no focus puller. So we were really kind of wandering around with the camera. You feel the intimacy because there's really no one around but Gus and I and River, and then eventually Grace.
When River started doing his thing, it just transformed a lot of the work. Everyone could see that he was just turning in such a tremendous performance, and he was so deeply into his character that I think the shooting every day and certainly the cutting responded to what he was giving us. River really came in and took control as far as the impact of his character and what that meant to the film as a whole. I would even say that the film, as originally envisioned, wouldn't be described as the story of that character Mike. That he was one character, a prominent character among this whole panorama of street kids and, you know, a view of life on the streets in Portland. But River really made it his own, and it was so overwhelming that I think the film went in the direction that it ultimately did for the better. River's presence was very important in the making of the movie because he was so engaged with the effort. I mean, he cared about the story, he cared about the group of us making the story, and he cared about getting it right. He was quite obsessive about getting this movie right. And early on, when a new draft of the script came out and it was time for him to sort of get on top of his lines, all he wanted to do was read his character out loud back and forth with somebody else. And he wanted to go through it again and again until it sort of sunk into his DNA. He felt that movie in every possible way, and I've rarely experienced such a level of engagement with the broadest sense of the filmmaking as I did with River.
I think River went to a place where he'd never gone before as an actor, and he was playing in a role. I think these roles were very risky for Keanu and for River, in that they were gay hustlers, and it was a very, the material was very risky. It was material that really hadn't been covered, you know. I mean, that's one of the things that was magical about this film, is that we were doing something that we felt we'd never done before. I think we all knew that, you know, we all sensed that, although you never know what the outcome of a movie is. When I see River in the scene where he's in the lobby and Bob is recounting his tale of the robbery, you know, there's moments where I just see River off camera, I mean in a cutaway, where he's just laughing or moving or reacting in a way that's so purely original. I've never seen anything like it. You know, it's to me, it was sort of like watching James Dean. There was this thing that I hadn't seen in actors in a long time, and it was like a place where You know, it was almost like everything River was doing was when the camera was rolling, was like almost an unexplored place.
What new trick do you have for us now, Bob?
You know, River had to do this film for almost no money, and his representatives were against him doing it. He had to be approached secretly, and he could very easily have not done the film, you know, just given the state of Hollywood mentality, even as it existed then. No one would ever realize just how great an actor he was and how much he had to say if it weren't for this film. River did a fair number of films, and he's very good in several of them, but I don't think there's anything he ever did that comes close to this.
I understand.
Do you?
Yes. I know how you feel.
I think I fell in love.